And Center for Public Policy Priorities will be back here February 7th in this room doing a House and Senate budget briefing, deep dive with our budget and revenue experts. So don't miss that one as well. Thanks again. I want to invite up Bea Moorhead to say a few words as well. Thank you all.
Oh my goodness. I'm Bea Moorhead, and I am not with the Center for Public Policy Priorities. I am with Texas Impact, and the reason that I'm here, yes?
I'm just going to move this
you
down.
You should move it down.
Because I'm the next speaker up.
There you go. Look at that. Oh my gosh. Are we bottomed out?
Okay.
It's terrible, I'll tell you. So I'm here to give you a plug for Cover Texas Now, which is the healthcare coalition that the Center for Public Policy Priorities, my organization, Texas Impact, and a number of the other organizations that you know and love, like Texans Care for Children, Children's Defense Fund, and a bunch of others, all participate in together. Cover Texas Now is the premier consumer, grassroots faith coalition for healthcare in Texas. Our motto is quality, affordable health insurance, sustainable healthcare system. And you can find Cover Texas online at www.covertexasnow.org. It's all spelled out, no abbreviations. We're also on Facebook and Twitter, as are all of the member organizations. We're not only interested in Medicaid and HHS kind of healthcare issues, we're also interested in issues that more relate to Texas Department of Insurance. I'm assuming Stacy Polk's probably going to talk to you about that. Our lobby day is March 6th. We hope you all will be looking forward to that and encouraging constituents to come participate. It's going to be a great day. We're expecting a huge number of people. Chase D'Anderson in the back from Children's Defense Fund is taking the lead on it, and I think it's going to be a wonderful event. We even have food, right?
Barbecue lunch.
The last thing I'll say is Cover Texas Now really represents four legislative offices, a huge range of expertise. We have policy experts from Center for Public Policy. We have various grassroots organizations that have members in your districts. We have people who can give you consumer stories and stories of people who do have insurance, don't have insurance. So please look at Cover Texas Now as kind of a comprehensive resource for legislative offices on healthcare issues. Thanks, and I'll turn it back over to Oliver or whoever comes up next.
This is where I find out if the clicker works. I'm Ann Dunkelberg, and I am an associate director at the Center for Public Policy Priorities, and I work on healthcare issues mostly. And as you know, I'm pointing it the wrong way. That's the problem. There we go. We are not going to go into the origin story of the Center for Public Policy Priorities, but if you didn't know that we were founded by Benedictine Sisters, that's something you need to know, and someday you should hear the whole story. We wanted to start just by telling you, recapping sort of what we're going to try to accomplish today and what we hope will be the takeaways that we will be able to get across, and we'll come back to it at the end. Our main topic, ACA repeal and what the stakes are for states. My computer's gone to sleep already. That will include possible mechanisms for repeal and the processes for those, as well as some of the things that we need to be understanding and looking for in any kind of replacement package for the ACA, which is already being discussed, as you know. And then we will spend some time on Medicaid block grants, and we'll do like a, you know, really rapid kind of Medicaid fundamentals so that the rest of it makes sense, and then talk a little bit about, and including a little bit about how it interacts with the state budget, and then talk about several different angles on how changing the federal law to block grant Medicaid would change the Medicaid program and where the areas for potential harm might be. The big takeaway, you know, really that we want you to have is that if we had repeal of the ACA without immediate replacement, or if we had block granting of Medicaid under anything but the most perfect circumstances, like if I got to create the block grant, then we would be looking at some big reversals in coverage of Texans. You know, a big spike again, a loss of our progress on the uninsured in Texas. And some of the outcomes that we would be expecting would be obviously human outcomes, financial hardship and difficulty for the people who lose coverage or can't get coverage, damage to Texas healthcare providers and hospitals in particular would take some harsh blows in a worst case scenario. And I think one of the things that everybody needs to understand is that every recent congressional proposal for Medicaid block grants or per capita caps has assumed a major reduction in Medicaid funding. And this is one of the sort of things we need to help lawmakers understand, overcome, because we keep encountering people who somehow got under the impression that a block grant would give us more money. But no, that is not what Congress has in mind. And then finally, what block granting Medicaid does for Congress is essentially say, okay, this is how much we're spending and then we're out of it and any overrun is on you, Texas. And unfortunately, that probably has implications for cost shifts down to the county level and county and municipal governments, just as they have to bear a fair amount right now. Now, in terms of implications for the Texas legislature, I'm sorry, I can't see through my glasses. There's not a lot. This is all federal action, and we'll recap this at the end. But our biggest goal for today's conversation is to do what we can to start making staff and members more fully understanding of the expected impacts of ACA repeal and replace, the kinds of things that we need our congressional delegation to be fighting for at the federal level. And they're going to need to hear from the people in this building in order to work in Texas' best interest on that. There is a possibility that some of the things that are shaping up this spring may make it obvious that there's going to be a need for some state-level legislation to predispose or pre-equip state government to move forward, to enact some sort of choice. This is one of the reasons we need to pay close attention to the federal debate, and we could see Texas legislation on that. There may be some movements for Texas to replace some of the health insurance consumer protections that are in the Affordable Care Act, but it's important to understand that only about a third of people with private commercial insurance in Texas are subject to state regulation. Most of the rest of us who work for self-insured companies are in fact regulated by the feds, and we cannot, no matter what we do here at the state legislature, we can't change that. As I mentioned before, if there were some sort of legislation at the federal level posing a question about whether or not to block grant Medicaid or go for a per capita cap, the legislature might feel that they need to leave here whenever they go home at the end of one or two or three sessions, we don't know. But they may feel that they have to pass something signifying their decision. It is also important to understand that legislation that we passed in 2011 as part of that session, Senate Bill 7, probably creates adequate authority for them to make major changes in the Medicaid program, if not explicitly block granting it, tantamount to that. And then finally, one other legislative thing that may be floating through that is a bit of a silver lining to the cloud of this discussion is we could see, as the state moves forward into the next extensions of our Medicaid 1115 waiver that some of you will have heard of, we could find an opportunity to move forward with a coverage program for low-income adults, which we don't have today. And there will be plenty of challenges to go along with that, but that could be something positive that we could find ourselves working on during the session. So I think the next slide, this is Stacy Pogue is a senior policy analyst who's gonna talk to you about a lot of the ACA and ACA repeal considerations. My colleague Melissa McChesney is also gonna talk about some of the Medicaid interfaces. They are both amazing and wonderful, and I can't thank Melissa enough for making this presentation look halfway decent. Somebody wanna help Grace?
You need to do the one from the...
Oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't advancing, was I? I got spoiled last week, I had somebody doing it for me. So I don't need to now because it's actually Stacy's turn to come up to the mic. And hopefully she'll do a better job of advancing the slides, Grace.
Yep, just hop again, and I'll fix it.
Okay. All right. So we'll talk about ACA repeal and replacement. I'll make sure. Okay. Oh, sorry. Okay. Sorry, Grace. It's going to make more sense now. I'll keep up with you.
Okay.
You can raise that up if you need to. No, the whole podium.
Oh. I think I'm okay. Can you guys hear it? I feel like the less I mess with this, the better. Okay. So you've probably heard Texas has the highest uninsured rate. That's been true for a long time. We have the highest uninsured population. Despite those facts still being true, we had a historic reduction in the uninsured population and rate in Texas under the ACA. And just a quick data snapshot before we start on repeal. The most recent census data, the most current census data we have available is for 2015. So we've had a reduction in our uninsured population of over 1 million Texans since the ACA coverage reforms expansions took place, and a 5 percentage point drop in our uninsured rate from 2013 to 2015. And for some context, before the ACA, we never had even a 1 percentage point drop in the uninsured rate in a year. And so this is a huge improvement. There's still lots of room, work to be done. The ACA has done a lot for coverage in Texas, even in Texas, where we haven't fully embraced it. So the next thing I'm gonna talk about is the ACA repeal replace. Before I start on that, though, I need to give you some caveats that this process is very fluid. Nobody knows, I don't think, outside of some leaders in Congress exactly what's happened, what's gonna be in a repeal bill, when it's gonna happen, what it's gonna do. The information changes daily, and we're trying to stay on top of it, but I just wanna make sure that you guys know the information I'm giving you. If I was giving you this exact same presentation next week, some of it would look different, and that's just the nature of the information that's available and how fast things are changing. So what's on the table right now for how the ACA could be repealed is through a maneuver called budget reconciliation in Congress. It allows the Senate to pass a bill with only 51 votes. It's not subject to a filibuster, which would require 60 votes in the Senate. So it can move faster and pass with less support, but there's some limitations on what can be put into a budget reconciliation bill. The provisions in it have to be ones that touch essentially the budget or taxes. It has to be related to the budget. And that has some implications for what might happen after the reconciliation bill is passed. So here are some possible paths for it. Again, I won't repeat the caveats, but keep them in mind. One of the big potential pathways being discussed is what people are calling repeal and delay. So the ACA would be repealed in part through a reconciliation bill that could pass much faster sometime in the next few months. And some provisions would be repealed immediately, possibly some taxes, the individual mandate, but others would have a delay date and wouldn't take effect for 2 to 4 years in the future. After that, Congress would pass a second bill or bills to replace the ACA, and those would go through the normal legislative process, which requires 60 votes in the Senate. The repeal and delay route allows for an earlier vote, a much more quick vote on repeal, but it has some real notable downsides, which could be destabilizing the individual insurance market, and I'm coming back to that. People losing coverage possibly quickly, and if any of the pieces that funded the ACA, because the ACA was, there was a package of both cost savings and significant new revenue sources in the ACA to fund it, if those are repealed, it makes it a lot harder to pass a replacement bill because you have to replace all of those mechanisms to pay for coverage, and it's hard to get consensus on those ideas. So another idea that you hear more, or at least a handful of senators specifically talking about now, is trying to repeal the ACA with a replacement plan simultaneously, or having it in hand, knowing what it's gonna contain and having consensus around those ideas. The problem is that takes longer, right? That takes 60 votes in the Senate, at least for some parts of it, and would push out that horizon. And I think there's also a possibility that it'll be something in between both of these. And so right now, Congress is in Philadelphia for their policy retreat. I think it started yesterday and it's gonna go today and tomorrow. And as you'd suspect, ACA is high on the agenda. And I think the information coming out of Speaker Ryan yesterday was that they're now trying to find ways to repeal the ACA through reconciliation, or parts of it, and replace parts of it through reconciliation as well. And so the question mark there will be what provisions could be put in reconciliation that would be considered replacement along with it. So it might not fall in one of these buckets. It might be something in between. So the things that can go through reconciliation could be repealed. Oh, there's no bill language today. Sorry, this is another caveat. There is no reconciliation bill to look at that folks are working through today. Congress did repeal the Affordable Care Act in 2005. President Obama vetoed it. And so that was also through reconciliation, and lots of folks who are trying to analyze what could happen are looking at that bill as a blueprint. It may not be what Congress uses, but that's what some of the analyses you'll see are based on. And in that bill, the things that were repealed through reconciliation included subsidies for that help people buy coverage in the health insurance marketplace, Medicaid expansion, the individual penalty, the mandate, the employer mandate, and the taxes that funded the ACA. But the kinds of things that the ACA passed that you can't repeal through reconciliation are the requirement, the prohibition that's placed on insurance companies. It says you can't turn people down if they're sick or charge them more if they're sick or have pre-existing conditions. Or the benefit standards for what kinds of coverage you have to sell to small employers or an individual market, and preventive care with no co-pays. So again, there's lots of things in the ACA that don't directly touch the federal budget as well. So here's my mocked up roadmap of the steps through reconciliation. Again, this is all subject to change. The first steps have already been taken though. So a couple on January 11th and January 13th, the Senate and House passed the first step of a reconciliation bill, which is a resolution to start the whole process and get the budget reconciliation moving. The next thing is that the House committees will have to work on the reconciliation bill, and I suspect that when they get back from the retreat starting next week, that will be one of the things that's very high on the agenda. Speaker Ryan has said that he would hope that the reconciliation bill to repeal parts of the ACA could be on the House floor to be voted on in the last week of February or the first week in March. So I don't know if that particular timeline's possible, but certainly it's what his goal that he stated yesterday was. The experts we're talking to say that when it moves to the Senate, it will likely skip the committee process, and I'm not sure if that's, you know, how certain people are of that, but it would go then to the Senate floor for debate. It's not subject to a filibuster. There's a limited amount of debate hours, and then would be up for a vote. Any differences between what the House and Senate do would have to be worked out in a conference committee, and then it could be signed into law. I don't think there's any defined goal on when it could be all the way through the process at this point. A couple weeks ago there was one, but the last I've heard, the goal that's on the table now is for how fast it could get out of the House, being the beginning of March. Okay, so one of the ways the Affordable Care Act made coverage available to folks, especially in the individual market, so quickly on that. When I say that, I mean people who don't get insurance through their jobs and need to go buy it on their own. They buy it directly from an insurance company. And this existed well before the Affordable Care Act, right? And so the Affordable Care Act also has health insurance marketplaces where you could buy coverage directly in the individual market. But when I talk about individual market, I'm not just talking about the health insurance marketplace, you know, the million people or more that are in it, or the 900,000 of subsidies. I'm also talking about people who buy at full cost outside of the marketplace, because they don't get coverage through their job, they're self-employed, or their employer doesn't offer coverage, and that's another 900,000 Texans. So in the individual market, under the ACA, insurers had to sell to everyone. You couldn't turn someone down if they're sick or charge them more. But because that would result in people waiting to get insurance till they were sick, there was an individual mandate that said if you can afford it, you need to buy insurance, and there were subsidies along with it to make that affordable to folks. And so, I think members of Congress are talking about getting rid of at least two of these things, possibly, and a repeal of the ACA, the individual mandate, and the marketplace subsidies. And one of the things that could result from that, and insurers or actuaries will be concerned about, is if you tell people they don't have to buy insurance, but you tell insurance companies you have to sell it to everybody at the same price, you'd see that younger and healthier people would drop their coverage. The pool of people who are covered would get sicker on average. Insurance companies would have to raise rates to account for that. And the cycle then would repeat. The healthier and younger people that maintained coverage when their rates go up 20%, they would drop it, and the sicker people would hold on to it. It's called a death spiral. It's a very dramatic, in my opinion, term, but it is something that's happened in individual health insurance markets in certain places. So it's not just theoretical. But so some of the American Academy of Actuaries, for example, has warned that if repeal is done without a replacement, there could be enough uncertainty to destabilize the individual market in certain places, and that the market could actually collapse before replacement plans in place. Again, that would affect 1.8 million Texans in and out of the marketplace. So some examples of what experts think might happen with a repeal through reconciliation without a replacement in hand. would be that even starting this year, you could have some insurers leave the market and some people lose coverage, but probably most of the effect would be next year for coverage year 2018. You'd see premiums rise and insurance companies exit markets where they're selling today. So the charts with the arrows, the Congressional Budget Office put this out in the last week or two, what they'd expect in a reconciliation repeal without a replacement plan in hand. Premiums would climb by 20 to 25% in the individual market next year, and they'd double by 2026. And coverage would be unavailable in the individual market for in areas where 10% of the population lives starting next year, and that would climb to 75% in 2026. And then the uninsured population would grow. On the uninsured graph on the far right here, I want to note that the Urban Institute is actually projecting that in a repeal with no replacement, 4.3 million people, that's in the U.S., would lose their coverage starting this year, not essentially immediately, not just waiting for 2018, but the big jump would be in 2018 when insurers exit markets and premiums go up. The only number we have that any of these experts have projected for Texas is that 2.6 million people would lose their coverage. They would be newly uninsured in Texas in 2019 in a repeal with no replacement. And I should say, the Urban Report just put out today, on my way here, I saw a report where they interviewed CEOs of insurance companies from 28 different states about different kind of repeal and replacement scenarios. And the information they got directly from interviewing insurance company executives aligned with this other research they've done that showed in those kinds of scenarios where there's so much uncertainty that you'd see insurance companies leaving markets or raising rates, especially starting in 2018. Okay, turning the page a little bit, there was an executive order that President Trump signed on January 20th that in general terms directed federal agencies to find ways to dismantle the ACA within existing law if it imposes any burdens or costs on individuals or states. I think the important thing to know about that is there was not a specific change or immediate change directed in that order. It's likely that it just encourages and makes clear to agencies and the public that his administration wants agencies, once they have heads, to start finding ways through rules or guidance to walk back some of the provisions of the ACA. Probably those changes won't happen before the heads of agencies are confirmed, or at least that's unlikely. And any change in rule would still have to go through the rulemaking process, but there's a lot of things in the ACA that were done in guidance that could be changed quickly. So some of the things that could be changed that aren't changed by the executive order directly but could be under the guidance of the executive order are more exemptions to the individual mandate or less enforcement of the individual mandate against things that through these interviews with insurers, things that would cause a lot of uncertainty about what kind of enrollment you'd have next year and what kind of utilization, how healthy or sick that population would be that would be covered next year if there was less enforcement of the mandate. But so you know, and I'm sure you know, the ACA reaches well beyond the individual market. I focused on that because that's where folks have the most concerns for very dire consequences that could be much quicker in a repeal and delay scenario. But the ACA actually, it created consumer protections and benefits and lots of different kinds of insurance. So as a reminder, this is how Texans get insurance. 7% of people have individual market or non-group insurance. Again, about half subsidized, half are buying at full cost. But 48% of us have insurance through our employers. There's Medicaid and Medicare that cover a large percent of a sizable share of the population. And it's important to note that the ACA had protections in all of these different plans. And the reason is, one, is because some of those things could be walked back through regulation or guidance, some of those quickly. And we need to keep those in mind when we're talking about ACA replacement plans to consider how those should be evaluated and what needs to be contained in those. Oh, geez Louise, how did I back up? Sorry, Grace. Okay. One thing people talk about a lot is pre-existing conditions, right? So 27% of non-elderly Texans have a pre-existing condition. And this is a condition that would have caused them a denial in the pre-ACA individual market, right? Enough of a condition, a health concern, that an insurance company would have said, no, you can't get coverage before the ACA passed. Now, not all of those Texans are at risk of that today. Most of us, again, have coverage through job-based insurance, Medicare, Medicaid, and we've got protections. But it's important to note that a fourth of our population, if they lost that coverage, if they aged out of Medicaid, if they were switching jobs and needed to get individual market insurance, would be denied coverage in a without the ACA, or protection that's replaced that's somewhat equivalent, right? Here's some other protections for job-based insurance. It also applies to the marketplace and individual market, but to keep in mind, because probably most people in this room have job-based insurance, there is no copays for preventive care. There was a removal of the lifetime limits. There's now a cap on your out-of-pocket cost, a protection against medical bankruptcy in case something really bad happens. We all know young adults can stay on your parents' plan because you're until age 26, because that one's talked about a lot. But there's also no waiting period if you do have a pre-existing condition and you're starting job-based coverage and you didn't have continuous coverage. Everyone has a right to an independent external review if your insurance company denies your care, and there's some limits on skimpy plans. You have to at least cover hospitalization even for these large employers. There's more protections for small employers, even all the ones I just listed, but additional ones, like a guarantee of decent coverage. There's something called essential health benefits, which say you have to have things like hospitalization, maternity care, mental health care, and that mental health care has to be at parity with medical care. Protections against wildly variable and discriminatory rates that were common in the small group market or for small employers before the ACA, and an annual review of rate increases. There were protections in Medicare too. The preventive care with no copay was added to Medicare as well, and changes to the ACA shored up Medicare's hospital trust fund and added 11 years of solvency to that fund. It also closed the prescription drug donut hole, which lowered drug costs for people in Medicare. I'm going to turn it over to Melissa McChesney, who's going to tell you more about Medicaid innovation with ACA.
All right, so we're just going to do a quick slide here on some of the changes to the Medicaid program that came through the ACA that we're not going to talk about Medicaid expansion right now. That'll come later. But these are some of the lesser known. Medicaid expansion is the big talked about piece to expand Medicaid to low-income adults. But there were also additional coverage expansions that were not optional for states necessarily, and also some improvements to the efficiency of how eligibility is determined, both from a policy and system perspective. So first was the expansion of Medicaid to former foster care youth. Stacy mentioned earlier the very popular provision of the ACA that allows people to stay on their parents' coverage till they're 26. Well, if you age out of the foster care program here in Texas at age 18, the Affordable Care Act required an expansion of Medicaid to cover those individuals until their 26th birthday on the Medicaid program. The community first choice option, this is an option for states, but it allows them to provide home and community-based attendant services and supports to eligible Medicaid enrollees. Along with that option also came a 6 percentage point enhanced match rate. And then finally, the CHIP mega enhanced match. So now here in Texas, we get 92 cents on the dollar for all of our CHIP kids. So that's a huge increase from where it was before this enhanced match was put into place, a 23% point increase overall. So any repeal of the ACA could potentially touch some of these enhanced dollars or expansions of the coverage. Along with those enhanced dollars and expansions came a revamped, sort of modernized way to do eligibility in the Medicaid system. And the reason that that this was put into place was the idea was you had you needed a streamlined interface between the marketplace subsidies that were available when you go to the individual market and the Medicaid program, so that when people's income changed and they needed to shift between programs, that could be done fairly seamlessly and with a lower impact on the consumer. So what that meant was you had to change the Medicaid income rules. So here in Texas, we spent several years changing those rules in order to align with the adjusted gross income rules, or your taxable income, basically. And there was also removals of the asset tests, removals of more archaic eligibility processes like face-to-face interviews. All of this was put into place to make the process more efficient and less burdensome on the consumer. This goes along with the no wrong door, so no matter where you apply, either with the Medicaid agency or with the marketplace, you'll get to the right place depending on your income. So that was put into place as well. And increased use of third-party data systems in order to verify eligibility. So you don't have to provide your birth certificate anymore. We can just look at the Social Security Administration data and verify that for you. So all of that was put into place here in Texas, and some pieces are still being put into place. And in order to pay for that, we got enhanced match rate on any development with 90 cents on the dollar, and any operationalizing that afterwards with increased staff needs or maintenance of that of the IT systems was 75 cents on the dollar. That has been made permanent, but again, could be undone through a repeal. And so the big question for these pieces is which pieces could be undone through repeal or executive action. And I'm going to turn it back over to Stacy.
Okay, there's one last piece on ACA repeal. I just want to go over briefly, this is not going to be with any sort of depth, common ideas in Republican ACA replacement plans. First, the replacement plan ideas vary. Some are just an outline, some are full legislative language. Two were introduced in the Senate this week. There are many, many plans. There is no consensus yet. Nobody's coalescing around one particular plan. But there's some common ideas in lots of them. So probably in all of them, one thing you see is that there's no individual mandate. And it's replaced in many of them by a continuous coverage provision. So a guarantee that you wouldn't be charged more or turned down if you have a pre-existing condition, as long as you maintain coverage. You continuously are covered. And if you're not, if you have a gap in coverage, which by the way is pretty common for people to have small gaps in coverage, if you had a gap in coverage, you could be charged more for a pre-existing condition possibly or turned down, and there's variance on that. Some of the plans contain high-risk pools as a place where people could get coverage. Most states had high-risk pools before the ACA. We don't have one in Texas anymore. I'll note that risk pool in Texas had no state funding. It had meager federal funding. And so if that was actually going to be a mechanism that could help insure people, it would have to look remarkably different than Texas's former high-risk pool, which I think at its peak covered 28,000 Texans, which is a drop in the bucket. One of the popular provisions you hear people talking about, President Trump is one of them, is selling insurance across state lines. And I think from a health policy perspective, this is probably more of a talking point than a substantive piece that would cover more people. There isn't a magical, mythical state where health insurance coverage was cheap and affordable and covered everybody, even if you're sick before the ACA. But it is something that's part of the discussion, is would selling it across state lines increase competition? I can say it's legal in three states, and no insurance company has taken up the offer, right? It's been tried. There is a regional aspect to health insurance, which is the product you're buying has a network of doctors that are near you, not in some other state. And so some of the logistic issues make that hard to be meaningful in a practical sense. A lot of the bills promote health savings accounts. So these are tax-advantaged accounts. They're not health insurance, but they reduce the cost of your purchases of healthcare, possibly health insurance, by making the money in them not taxable. So there's more advantage to higher income people who have health savings accounts than lower income individuals. But the piece that matters there is whether they're funded, right? Low-income people rarely have money left at the end of the month to put in a savings account for health or for anything else. And so health savings accounts would need to also have a mechanism to fund them to make sure people could afford health care. There's lots of different variants also on the tax credits. The ACAS subsidies, which are in fact advanceable tax credits, but a lot of the plans replace them have advanceable or refundable or some sort of tax credit, often based on age instead of income. The ACA's is based on income, and often less generous than the help that the ACA provides for lower income individuals. And then there's some ideas of essentially punting to the states. Some decisions or all the decisions or parts of the decisions and parts of the replacement is deferring that back to the states to make some decisions. So I'm gonna stop again. That's just a quick outline of some of the replacement plans. And if you want, do you want me to take if anybody has two questions,
we don't have to count them, but we're going to take about 5 minutes worth of questions before we go on to the next section if people have them.
Yeah. So the next section is all on Medicaid. We're going to have a lot more information coming up, but if you have anything you want clarified on this piece or to talk about on this piece, I'm happy to. All right.
Amazing.
I have a question.
Oh, sure.
There
you go. Can you talk a little bit more about what ACA repeal of the enhanced match for SHIP kids, how that would impact the suit?
Anne can totally do that.
So the question was how would repeal of the super enhanced match for CHIP affect the state? And you know, obviously that's not going to happen in a vacuum. So, I mean, you know, that change won't happen all by itself. So it's pretty hard to say that. If we are looking next summer at Medicaid getting turned into a block grant, we would probably see some associated changes to the Children's Health Insurance Program as well. We don't know yet what Congress will try to do there. So basically, CHIP already had a better match rate than Medicaid. It was in the low 70s in Texas, but I'm not doing my math right. It must have been in the high 60s, and because we got 23 percentage points added to it, and now we're at 92. So it would obviously not be nearly as affordable for Texas. And I think it's not like the legislature has made major changes in how it treats CHIP, because since 2015 we've had this enhanced match rate. It just means, once again, they would have to pick up a larger share of it. They might be more inclined to make cuts. Any other questions on the ACA repeal and replace portion? Well, in that case, now once again you're stuck with me trying to remember that I have to advance my slides. I do want you to do my slides. Will you do that?
Yes.
Okay, that'd be great. So we're starting with a Medicaid and CHIP overview, and this is, I'm just gonna kind of fly through this. In fact, I called it a drive-by because I'm gonna try to do it so quickly. It's like, what's in front of my screen? Oh, it's Stacy. So anyway, moving right along to the Medicaid CHIP overview, the next slide. Just the basics are that Medicaid and CHIP provide health insurance coverage to certain low-income individuals. Oftentimes the press leave that qualifier out, and as a result there are many lawmakers and other Americans who think everybody who's in poverty gets Medicaid, and it's a long way from that. Anyway, certain low-income individuals, and the costs are shared between the state and the federal government. Medicaid is legally an entitlement program, and anybody who meets the eligibility standards that a state has set up has to be served unless or until the state actually changes those eligibility standards. CHIP legally is not an entitlement program in Texas, but in Texas so far all eligible children have been served. We have not had caps or waiting lists in our CHIP program, although in theory that is something a state could have done in the past when the law was first created. This is the most recent month of Medicaid enrollment data that we have in Texas, and I like to show it to people first so you understand that Medicaid and CHIP, that Medicaid is mostly children in Texas, so you can see that great big slice. This is from back in September. A little over 3 million children were enrolled in Texas Medicaid. And you can see that the two largest groups there that aren't children are seniors and people with disabilities. I'm sorry, I skipped over CHIP. So you got 3 million in Medicaid, about 374,000 in September kids on the CHIP program. Then the two largest adult groups are adults with disabilities and seniors who are below the poverty line. Then you have a much smaller population that's poor parents, and you will note that that was only a little over 150,000 parents in September. So 3 million children qualify for Medicaid, and only 150,000 of their parents. That was one of the common misunderstandings about the Medicaid expansion debate, was that it was all childless adults. Not true. Hardly any parents of Texas children on Medicaid qualify for Medicaid today. And then finally, the last slice you see is the maternity slice. So that's a very, very important part of the Medicaid program. In Texas, it's more than half of the births in Texas are paid for by Medicaid, and that's common to most of the states. We're not gonna delve too deeply into this, but if you're wondering how on earth you end up with 3 million children on Medicaid and only 150,000 of their parents, this is the answer. That middle bar that's so low that has the red circle around it is the income cap for parents on Texas Medicaid. Your Texas legislature adopted the income cap for this group in 1985 as a fixed dollar amount. It has never had any inflation factor or been updated, so it's the same number now pretty much as it was when I was in graduate school. There's some slight adjustments to this that came along because of the ACA that are too wonky to get into. That's one of the reasons I put in red over on the side. If you had an ACA repeal, there would be some slight adjustments of this. The one that you may remember is that they evened out some of the eligibility between Medicaid and CHIP so that all children up to 138% of poverty get Medicaid now. There used to be some stair-step issues there. This is a slide from my friends at the Children's Hospital Association in Texas. It's a couple of years old, but the numbers won't have changed very much, certainly in proportion. And one of the things they're getting across is that nearly half of Texas children are enrolled in Medicaid or CHIP. and that the saturation in a county, how much your population is relying on Medicaid and CHIP, varies enormously. So you have some counties with 70% of their children enrolled in either Medicaid or CHIP, and then you have some with as low as 10%. And you can certainly understand how that would change a legislator's level of concern about the program, at least as in as much as it affects children, which is quite a bit. We're not going to dwell on this slide. The point I want to take away in the next few slides is Medicaid is not unusually expensive. And what is unusual about Medicaid is that the state government is responsible for a big share of it. But these two slides, one looks back and one looks forward, and both of them show you that the per capita cost, the per enrollee cost in Medicaid, is consistently much lower than it is for you, the private insurance that you and I have. It has been way more controlled and has grown at a much slower rate than health care that you and I have, and in most cases less than Medicare as well. Over the next few years, and the graph looking forward, it looks like they expect Medicaid to pop a little ahead of Medicare. That's probably based on ACA provisions for cost containment in the Medicare program. But the bottom line is there's not something exceptionally out of control about the per capita costs of Medicaid, which runs counter to some of the narrative that you hear a lot in political circles. The next slide shows, this is from your legislative budget board. So this is clipped right from Fiscal Size Up, which we wonks love. And one of the great things that they've done in Fiscal Size Up is these ball charts where you can see that in the general revenue budget for Texas, so this is the current biennium, that the Article 3 of education is still quite a bit larger than Article 2. So another narrative that you will hear is that Medicaid has swamped out education. Now, I don't say any of the things I'm saying right now to suggest that healthcare costs are not a serious problem and that the United States doesn't spend too much on healthcare and get too little for what we spend. It is a serious issue. But the point I'm trying to make is that Medicaid does not have some kind of exceptional problem. In fact, it is probably one of the more efficient pieces of our healthcare system. The reason states don't like it is because they are responsible for funding it, unlike Medicare or the private insurance that all of us have, except for the ones of you who work for the legislature. This is a slide from our colleague Eva DeLuna, who is also taken directly from the LBB's Fiscal Size Up data. And in it, you can look a little bit more carefully at breaking out. Article 3, of course, includes higher ed and K-12. And this one shows you that when you look at the GRR budget on the left, Health and Human Services is still significantly smaller than K-12 education. And it's only when you add in the federal match that you have a larger share. Medicaid is the number one source of federal funds in every state budget in every state. It's the number one way that your income taxes come back to your state, to the state budget. The only other thing that outstrips it would be military spending, which is of course different in every state, and that doesn't flow through state budgets. It goes directly to the military installations. So Medicaid is by far the number one way federal dollars come back to state budgets. And then finally, this is just a sort of an overall slide. It's from the Congressional Budget Office, and really all it does is show you that second bar from the left is Medicaid and CHIP, and that Medicaid and CHIP make up about 18% of total healthcare spending in the United States. You can see that payments by private health insurers, which is that sort of wide burnt orange bar there, is way by far, you know, that's the big gorilla in this country. So even though Medicare and Medicaid costs are and should be of concern, it is, again, an inaccurate narrative to suggest that Medicaid is the big gorilla and that it has some special problems that are worse than the rest of the healthcare system. One other thing that's important to understand, because it's going to be important when we start talking about block grants, are Medicaid provider payments. There are almost no federal minimum standards for what states can pay providers. And since there are minimum standards on benefits and there are some minimum standards on eligibility, it means that provider payments become a really easy target for states when they're trying to find a way to shrink their Medicaid budget. As a result, over the last 20 years, Texas, or over 20 years ago, when I worked for the state Medicaid director in the early 90s, we first stopped doing regular annual updates to, for example, physician payments. And around the same time, we did some similar things to hospital payments. So physician payments have not had any annual, and other individual professionals that are paid under Medicaid. They've had no regular annual updates since the early 1990s. There have been a handful of increases and a handful of cuts. So the point of all of this is, when you have this kind of situation, and provider payments are falling further and further and further behind inflation and the cost of providing care, it obviously creates, can take a toll on access to care, and it very much accounts for why you hear sometimes the same people who are voting on the appropriations complaining about access to care in Medicaid, even though it was their decisions that set those low reimbursement rates. It's a very, very thorny situation there. And then finally, we're not going to delve deeply into this, but this is a slide about where we are at this very beginning of this budget process on Medicaid and in the state legislature. And just to call attention to the fact, and you know, maybe we'll have another meeting on this next week, but the Senate has done some pretty unprecedented things in their proposed budget. So they've filed a budget that acts as though there will be no supplemental appropriation to finish 2016-2017 for Medicaid, and therefore does not have that money in the base for 18-19 either. And they have also not built into their budget over $700 million in GR that is part of the budget instructions, is supposed to be part of the base, and that is the enrollment growth in Medicaid. So the House's budget has that money in it, but the Senate's doesn't. And then finally, the Senate budget has a rider in it that says, actually, we know there's a bottom line up here for the budget, but actually, you have to take $1 billion, just over $1 billion out of that, because this rider says everything in the budget except the foundation school program, that's the school funding formula, easy for me to say, everything but the foundation school program has to be cut by another 1.5%. So, and that's kind of unprecedented. It's very large, and if you were to do it by article of the budget, then Article 2 would have to be cut by something in the neighborhood of 490 million GR additionally to make up that cut. And any other place where you tried to cut back less than your 1.5% to protect it, like Child Protective Services, would mean you'd have to have a bigger cut somewhere else. We don't know yet what this means, but it's obviously, this is where we're starting, so it's a concern. So I'm going to take a short breath and see if anybody has any of those sort of Medicaid basic questions before we go on to talking about what the block grant proposals look like. Is there anybody who wants to?
One here. So this isn't really Medicaid, but I just wondered if you have anything on the budget. So before the budget process started, before the session started, they said that they make the 4% cut across the board, except for there were certain types of programs that fell out of that. Mental health was one of them. Mm-hmm.
Good question. So the question I'll repeat quickly was, you may recall that there was a requirement that in your LAR, every agency had to have a schedule about if you cut 4% out of your budget, where would you cut it from? And a number of things were exempt from that, including some pieces of Medicaid and mental health. And she was asking whether there were similar exemptions. As written, the only thing that is exempt from this billion-dollar 1.5% cut is the Foundation School Program. Now, we have no idea where this will end up. One of the points that the center has made, which is not entirely germane to today's discussion, but is just that, for example, you know, we spent $800 million on border security last time, and we're preparing to ask for another $300 million. If we don't do that, you know, there's $1 billion right there. So, I mean, it may be that the Senate budget writers already have a very specific plan for how they're going to back away from that additional billion-dollar cut, but nobody's heard about it yet. So it's just an open question at this point. And I think that's, you know, it's for them to explain to us what their intention is. Any other Medicaid 101? I think that may be more germane to the second half, so I am going to touch on that, Janice. Anything else? Go ahead, Grace. That's a good question that kind of goes with Stacy's thing, and it's actually one that I hadn't thought about. So the question is, if hospitals had a lot of ratcheting down of their potential funding streams through Medicare and Medicaid and other things in the Affordable Care Act because they were supposed to get this giant influx of newly insured people, and they did get an influx, it just wasn't giant in Texas. The states where there is Medicaid expansion, the hospitals have had a giant influx, and in fact, the Chicago Cook County Public Hospital, one of the busiest public hospitals in the country, had its first profit in its entire, like, 180-year history because of that. So anyway, it's a good question whether, you know, is there some offsetting benefit to hospitals because some of the things that are being ratcheted down. That is a hugely, it's a great example of why winding down the ACA is not a walk in the park. It's why you can't just repeal it, because it is one of the many things that helped offset putting in money for subsidies for insurance or for Medicaid expansion was trying to so-called bend the curve on Medicare costs. So it's a great question, but not one that I can answer. I'm going to go on into block grants before I get any more questions that I can't answer. All right. Let's go to the next slide. Block grant basics. So I'm going to go ahead and look at this because I can see it better. So here's one of the things to understand is that in current federal law, there's actually two pieces to entitlement, and one of them is the state has an entitlement. The state is entitled to federal funding for all of the people who are eligible for Medicaid and for the services that they've offered, you know, as long as the federal government has approved whatever the state is doing. There is also an individual entitlement that anybody who meets those eligibility standards, to the extent that they are allowable under federal law, they're going to get that coverage and they're going to get their services paid for. So it really is important legally that there are two different entitlements there, and both of them, you know, are potentially at threat when you move to a block grant structure. So, you know, just to the basics are that if you move to a block grant, you're disconnecting the level of funding you're getting from the number of Medicaid beneficiaries and the cost of providing their care. And at that point, as you move to a block grant, there are a million different ways to structure a block grant. No two block grants look alike, but the federal contribution is going to only grow according to the specific formula that's in the law that creates the block grant. And that could be, so it is no longer necessarily going to increase with population or with the population in need of coverage, and it's not necessarily going to grow along with the actual costs of healthcare for the population involved. So the challenge is, if a state is moving from the entitlement model to having to manage the Medicaid program with a fixed amount of funding, then probably the expectation is that in those models there is no longer an entitlement of the individual to coverage. That means that who gets the coverage, what the benefits are, and how people get paid would have to be restructured or repealed at the federal level. And so all of the guidelines that we are familiar with for Medicaid in Texas potentially are up for change. The big trade-off is, so what's appealing about this to the states is, to some states, not, and many governors over history, in my ridiculously long career, this is the third cycle of major block grant pushes I've been through. Unfortunately, it's also the one with the greatest degree of viability. And there are always governors who push back, including Republican governors, against this idea. And the reason is because this is a tough trade-off. Trade-off is, I know exactly what my Medicaid budget is for next year, supposedly. The feds are going to give me this much, and I decide I'm going to spend that much, and when that money runs out, we're just done. You know, we're not going to give any more services, we're not going to enroll anybody else. The bad news is that means that now every single, or part of the bad news, is that every single year Congress has to approve this. It's no longer part of the entitlement part of the budget like Medicare and Social Security that is funded every year. And so every year it becomes part of the budget squabble in Congress. So all those times that you remember having, you know, budget standoffs and wondering if the mail was going to be delivered or the national parks were going to be open, Medicaid would then become part of that. Is Medicaid going to be operating next week if Congress is in a budget stalemate? So you're trading one thing that you don't really like for another thing that arguably could be worse. And I think the other way to point that out is just that, you know, Congress set it up that way on purpose. You know, this wasn't an accident. They didn't want to be politically on the hook for that hard decision every single year. So I just think that's worth mentioning. Obviously, in addition to it being politically easier, it promotes stability. Stability, obviously, of people's confidence in their government, that their, you know, that their Social Security payments are, and their Medicare are going to come through, but also stability in the healthcare marketplace in terms of knowing that next year you can have a business plan and you're going to be able to keep your doors open and your staff employed. So this is a slide that has way too much stuff on it, according to, there we go. I want to go to the graphic, please. There we go. That has way too much stuff on it, but I just wasn't able to handle it unless it had all this stuff on it. It's like, I need to see all this information at the same time, so I'm sure you must feel the same way. So the bottom line is that we start with a formula here. And if we have a block grant in Texas and it's based on like this year's spending or historical spending for Medicaid, and then the formula inflates it, gives it an annual inflation factor that is significantly lower than the actual experience that we've had over the last decade or what's expected over the next decade, that this ends up, the result is a federal funding stream that continues to fall further and further behind what we actually need. Important to understand, as I said before, you could create block grants many, many different ways, and you could conceivably, if I were doing it, or several of you in the room were doing it, you could create a block grant that might not scare you to death in terms of your ability to continue to operate your health and your long-term care programs. But in fact, the ones that have been produced over the last several years, in some cases even sent to the president, have not met that test. So, soon-to-be Health and Human Service Secretary Price's bill, which was supported by Speaker Ryan, the Republican budget proposal for 2017 that was in Congress last summer, would have, over the first 10 years, cut Medicaid spending by $1 trillion below the expected baseline for Medicaid. And that's not something that only gets scary, and that's a 25% reduction, and that's not even taking into account Medicaid expansion. It was helpful that the people who did this analysis took that out of the numbers for us, since it would be really easy to say, well, that's just because of Medicaid expansion. It's not. It's a 25% funding reduction over 10 years, even without the Medicaid expansion. When you add in the expansion, that takes it up to a 33% reduction. And you can see from the graphic up there that even in the second year, it's already a 20% cut. That's a pretty big cut. So, one of the things that has occurred to me as I've thought about this over the last few days is that I don't know that we've talked about this much, is that one of the things that happens here is we have the consolidated budget from HHSC has a list, an interest list, which is always a little inflated because it has some out-of-date people on it, right? But it had 246,000 Texans on it who are waiting on waiting lists or interest lists for long-term care and community care waivers in Texas Medicaid. There is no way under this scheme that those people ever move forward. And that has been, even though we're never satisfied with the progress we make on reducing those waiver lists, we at least have made some progress every session. And that, there is nothing in any of the proposals we've seen so far that gets us, to a system that could make any progress on that, let alone all of those parents that we don't cover in Medicaid, the other uninsured adults. So that would be one of the things we'd be looking for if we're going to change the financing mechanism, how can we change it so that we can continue to make progress in Texas? I wanted to use this, give you something else to think about in terms of context. The therapy rate cuts that affected kids with disabilities and special needs, and some adults as well, from last session, the dollar amount for that was $75 million a year GR. I believe it adds up to about $171 million when you add in the federal funds. That was less than 0.5% of Texas Medicaid budget for 1 year. Less than 0.5%. So a 20% cut in Texas Medicaid federal funding would be $4.8 billion. So if by the second year of a block grant, our Medicaid program was operating at $4.8 billion below the 2016 level, just imagine the kinds of havoc that would be created if we had to deal with that and the kinds of decisions your bosses would have to be making. So I think this is where the rubber meets the road, and we're struggling to try to find ways to communicate this, you know, that you can use with your bosses and with the people they need to talk to. Oh, and the question mark that I put on the bottom part of the bar, that $4.8 billion of federal funds in the current world would have, you know, state matching funds that could go with it. And of course, under a block grant, we don't know what the state's requirements would be, you know, whether they would have to continue to have a similar maintenance of effort or match, exactly what it would be. So I just make that point that that's sort of an open question. So what else changes for Texans under a Medicaid block grant? I think it's important to kind of tick off a lot of the things that we take for granted. So benefits, today, children are guaranteed all medically necessary care, and care for kids can't have arbitrary limits on like the number of services you get or the days or the number of visits, those sorts of things. It has to be what's medically necessary. I'm not saying that never goes wrong, but that's the law. Adults don't have as much protection, but they do have minimum standards. And under a block grant, we would not necessarily have any of those minimum standards anymore. Affordability protections, right now you have exemptions of children and pregnant women from co-payments, as well as from premium type structures and those sorts of things. And that would likely go away under a block grant. Adults in Medicaid today can have co-payments, but they do have some upper limits on them. And not in regular Medicaid, but in some of the 1115 waivers in different states that they've used for expansion, they have had premium-like structures for adults, but they have also said you can't be tossed off of Medicaid for non-payment of those premiums, can't be frozen out of healthcare if you can't do your co-payments, and those kinds of protections would likely go along with an entitlement structure, go away, I mean, if we convert to a block grant, or it would be in question whether we would be able to keep them. What's covered, who is covered? So currently we do have a standard in every state that you have to cover kids up to at least 138% of the federal poverty income level, and in Texas the kids between that and 200% of poverty get CHIP. And then of course the pregnant women, there's a minimum standard for coverage of that. One of the things that would change if we had a dramatic reduction in Medicaid funding and we no longer had entitlement, is that states really could just say who they wanted to cover. And it means things like caps on enrollment and waiting lists for coverage beyond the ones that we already have for our community care programs, our long-term care services and supports, that we could have a waiting list for basic eligibility and caps on enrollment. And then, as I said before, I think it's worth, and it bears repeating, there's nothing in the structure of a block grant that would guarantee that the Texans would have a way to add in the tens and perhaps hundreds of thousands of Texans who are on waiting lists for long-term services and supports right now. Red tape. So we do have some protections. One of the things, a lot of these are relatively new. One of the things that states did to try to slow enrollment even after the standards for covering, like covering kids, were increased over the last 20 years was they went, okay, well, we're gonna create a lot, we're gonna make it a real hassle to enroll and to renew your coverage, and that's a good way to keep eligibility down. When I first started doing this work, the applications were 20 to 25 pages long, and you had to have a face-to-face appointment to get your child enrolled. A lot has changed since then, and so we have a lot of protections against red tape, and we have due process rights if you get incorrectly denied, those sorts of things. We don't know what will become of those. We also have a lot of important protections right now. Many of you will already know that most of Texas Medicaid is privatized through health maintenance organizations, including most of our programs for Texans with disabilities now, including children. And there's a ton of regulatory and some legal consumer protections for Medicaid managed care consumers, and we don't know what the future of those would be under a conversion to a block grant. And then finally, something that will also be of interest to some of you is a couple of very special provisions. We have some freedom of choice provisions, and one in particular you would want to know about is currently you must have freedom of choice in a Medicaid program to pick the family planning provider of your choice. So anybody who meets the state's regulatory standards for being a family planning clinic or OB-GYN or whatever, that has to be available to you to make your own choice. That could go away. In addition, what the technical name of federally qualified health centers, sometimes called community health centers, the Texas Association of Community Health Centers is your association for that. Under current law, they have a very important protection that makes sure that they get reimbursed by Medicaid for something approximating their actual cost of providing care. And I can promise you that is one of the only reasons that they are so robust and playing such an important role all over Texas in providing access to care, you know, in places where there would be very little access at private offices for physicians, for example, and where there's a big demand for it. So that could also change for them. So all of these things will be in question as we go into federal legislation around anything that looks like conversion to a block grant or even a per capita cap, is what parts of the federal floor are going away. A couple of other things to worry about with block grants. And I think one of the questions that was teed up earlier is about this. So you've got 31 states out there that have Medicaid expansion. They are getting tens of billions of federal dollars, and they have millions of people who've gotten coverage under that. They're not going to want to give up that funding. So as Congress moves forward in debating whatever changes they're going to make, a lot of them, most if not all of them, will be fighting to try to keep that money. So then the question becomes, will states like Texas and the other 18 states that did not expand then be able to lay claim to those funds? A big question is, will the funding that's not really in our Medicaid program but is in our 1115 waiver, which was just asked about, which is a little separate kind of pot of money, will that be built in? A very important, one of the influential proposals that's been floated in Congress in the last couple of years actually proposed to stop allowing the use of local funds in Medicaid. And as you may know, our waiver is entirely funded with local taxpayer dollars. The state puts almost nothing into it. And so we couldn't sustain that part of our program. The other really important thing to know about the waiver is half of the money that hospitals in Texas get from Medicaid comes from either that waiver or another supplemental program called disproportionate share. And those are both completely funded with those local dollars. The state does not, your state budget, your state legislature does not contribute to those. So keeping our hospitals whole is going to be a serious challenge moving forward, something that we need to keep an eye on. Let's see, what else do we have? So one of the things, we talked about provider rates and the fact that they have lagged behind. We're not there yet, sorry, because I'm jumping around. We talked about provider rates and how they have not been kept up with inflation over the last 25 years, roughly. And so one of the things to keep in mind is, if we have a block grant that uses 2016 Medicaid expenditures as a base, it locks you in. It freezes you into all kinds of inadequate things, things about your Medicaid program that you may not really like. You may not be thrilled about the heavy reliance on local funds. You may not be thrilled about how low your physician payments are, but it locks you into those. So that's a serious concern for Texas. So what about the per capita cap piece? We're going to go on to that in a second. The per capita cap piece just really only changes one variable in what we've been talking about. It basically says, okay, we're going to make sure that whatever your funding stream is, you're going to at least get more money every year based on the number of people who qualify for your program. The question then becomes, will Congress do what Texas has done, which is not fully fund the cost of inflation or prices going forward? So you could have an adjustment for the number of people who potentially qualify for your Medicaid program and still not have adequate funding. So another thing that Texas will really have to keep a close eye on. So whether we're talking about a block grant or a per capita cap, for us to have a radically changed financing formula for Medicaid, we have to have something that responds to population growth, to increases in need for health care due to poverty or economic downturns, because you could have a big surge in need that is not necessarily reflected in your population growth, depending on the economy of your state, for example. You've definitely got to have the ability to respond to natural disasters, which we've seen a number of affecting Medicaid over the last decade. You have to have the ability to respond to an epidemic or some other kind of public health crisis. And you need to be able to respond to having enough money to be able to take advantage of really positive medical breakthroughs. For example, one that a lot of us in this room will be familiar with is we can now cure Hep C and save people's lives. And Texas has been one of the slowest programs to get that operating in their Medicaid program, and we still have some problems with it. So it's really important to be able to have whatever funding allocation you have adjusted to add in a new life-saving therapy, you know, assuming that that is the will of Congress. So if you don't pay attention to those things, whatever financing system you have, then it's simply a recipe for having more uninsured Texans and therefore shifting lots more in costs to your city and county governments, who are already, as you know, carrying a pretty substantial piece of care for the uninsured in Texas. Now, for the bad news, for more bad news, Congress's track record on maintaining the buying power block grants is pretty poor. And now we're going to go quickly to these maps, but only dwell on them for a second. Just to let you know, there is wild variation among the states in terms of what proportion of folks under 200% of poverty are covered in Medicaid, as well as how much we spend per recipient. And I believe the Commonwealth Fund did these maps, but you can find those 50 state comparisons on the Kaiser Family Foundation's website, where so much great information can be found, anything you need. So I'm really just making the point that, you know, if you're the state that's in that lowest quartile of spending per Medicaid recipient, locking you in at a 2016 block grant could be a really, really bad deal for your state. And Texas is only in the second quartile, so it's not a great deal for us either. Let's go to the next slide. This is Center on Budget did an analysis, and I think they did this about a year ago, of federal block grants, health and human service and housing block grants, going back to their inception. And this, if you read the piece, which you know, you'll have the source material from the slides, they actually go back to inception, but this graph just focuses like on the last 15 years. All of these block grants on average have dramatically lost buying power. Some of them have only lost a few percentage points of buying power. Some of them have lost close to 80% of their buying power. So it's really important to understand that there is no precedent in Congress to make us confident that they would keep a Medicaid block grant up with costs that states have. It will require, you know, extremely forceful attention if we go in that direction to create a system that actually is going to create some security and certainty for states in funding their health care. Otherwise, again, it just shifts the cost to city and county governments when the state doesn't have enough money. I'm sorry, Janice, I will not be entertaining questions for a couple more minutes. I have the thing there about how CHIP is the exception and not the rule. So our CHIP block grant, and there's some resources I can share with you if you want to read more about that, but our CHIP block grant was the first one Texas probably has ever gotten that was based on our need and not our historical spending. So that's one reason it's been good for us. We had the highest rate of uninsured kids in the country and a really high number, and they gave us a block grant back in 1999 that reflected that. And Congress has, the article that I would refer you to if you want to know more about it, Congress has passed more than half a dozen specific pieces of legislation designed to keep enhancing the CHIP block grant because they never wanted the CHIP block grant to be short-funded. But that did not prevent them from letting other block grants, really important block grants like the Social Services block grant and the Maternal and Child Health block grant, from plummeting in their ability to keep up with the need. So just one last thing about per capita caps. The per capita caps don't lend themselves to as great a graphic, I think, as the block grants do. But again, like I said before, it just sort of takes away one harmful characteristic of a block grant by saying, okay, we promise you that whatever formula you end up with, it's at least going to reflect enrollment growth. Unfortunately, all of the recent proposals, including Speaker Ryan's and Chairman Price's and several others, have only proposed to allow the block grant to grow or the per capita cap to grow at the rate of general inflation. And that could be a challenge. It's something for you to ask your favorite health insurer or hospital provider, you know, how far they feel like their cost growth curve falls from general inflation. There have been times in the last 20 years when medical inflation has been 2.5 times the rate of general inflation, and we don't like that, and everybody wants that to come down. But going cold turkey to general inflation is part of what can create those big drops, like that 20% reduction that we saw under the block grant. lots of different ways you could do the per capita cap, just like a block grant. You could have a per enrollee cap that is the same for every Medicaid recipient, or you could have different ones for kids and seniors and people with disabilities, or you could exempt some groups from the cap. They could apply to all Medicaid services or only certain services. And then again, the big, coming back to the big question of what is going to be the inflation factors that you allow. And I think the same issues around, is there enough here to allow us to respond to an economic downturn, natural disaster, et cetera, those things have to be thought about in a per capita cap formula as well. But it still presents the state with the same kind of fundamental trade-off, which is they're going to have to scale back a Medicaid program that they may feel like is already, in the case of Texas, somewhat bare bones to begin with. And so now, we're back to our implications for the Texas legislature. I'm just going to articulate them really quickly and then open it up for questions. And again, the reason we wanted to do this today, we sensed there was plenty of interest in the topic. It's hard to wade through the mass of information that's coming into my inbox on it, so we thought it might be helpful for us all to see if we can get on the same page on it. It's really critical that all of you and all of your bosses understand the potential damage to Texas if we do move to a Medicaid block grant or a per capita cap system, as well as the really broad potential impacts of ACA repeal that go way beyond just the 1.8 million Texans who are getting coverage through the ACA's marketplace. And so I'm just going to tick off again. It's possible we might see some legislation around triggering a state decision if we have legislation that seems likely to move in Congress about converting Medicaid to a block grant or per capita cap. You may see legislation designed to make up for the repeal of some of the consumer protections that are in the Affordable Care Act. I didn't mention it specifically, but one example that's on your, there's a fact sheet on your table, one example that's on there is mental health parity. Some of the biggest gains in mental health parity came through the ACA, which extended it to small employers and the individual marketplace. Did I get that right? Yes. Before, it only applied to the really big employers. Now it applies to the individual marketplace and small employers. So that's just another example of Texas might step in and try to make up for some of the stuff that goes away. But again, as Stacy has reminded us, only a third of Texans are in the part of the health insurance marketplace that's regulated by the state. I think we've already talked about, you know, whether or not we will see some kind of directive on block grants. We'll need to pay close attention to it because it's possible that existing state law already gives the leadership and the agency all the authority they need to move forward with this. And then, again, if we're looking for something that might be positive that we could be working on that's related to this whole debate, perhaps the ability to do some of the things that you couldn't do before with 1115 waivers will inspire our leadership to move forward with a Medicaid coverage program for low-income adults. There will be tons of challenges that would go along with that, but it is 251, and so I think we'll go ahead and open it up for questions, and then I can get something to drink.
I know you had a question before, Janice.
Maybe the data is not available, but I'm looking for your intuitive answer to whether these implications will get harder in rural areas versus urban, rural doctors being able to keep their doors open, rural hospitals being able to keep their doors open. Do you have any?
So the question is, do we expect a disproportionate, is there any data on, and I think I don't have any data on it, but there may be eventually, but do we have any idea or intuition about the disparate impact if we have some of these worst case outcomes and we have a big increase in the uninsured, for example, on rural providers and their viability, both individual providers and hospitals and other institutions. So those are the hospitals that are suffering the most right now. They have not gotten, in terms of hospitals, the bump from Medicaid expansion that hospitals in other states have gotten. And while, you know, the folks are benefiting from the increased enrollment in the marketplace in Texas that at least dropped our uninsured population by a little over a million, we also led the country in rural hospital closures. We're not starting from a great spot, and anything that is a downturn in the number of insured, you know, is a hit, especially on the hospitals, because as we all know, you know, they are not only sort of the providers of last resort, which is not to say we have wonderful entities like the federally qualified health centers that will pick up more people if the uninsured rate goes up, but the biggest expenses will fall on the hospitals, and it is important to note that the FQHCs, while they get a little chunk of money to take care of the uninsured, it's nowhere near enough to cover the actual costs of most of the uninsured who show up at community health centers. So there's no doubt. On the flip side, I know that I saw research over the last few years that suggested that in states that had Medicaid expansion, rural practices and hospitals would be much more viable because they would just, you know, they would have so many more paying patients who could come to them. So it is certainly not, if we do have a bad outcome from the debate that we're going through, you know, it is certainly going to take a toll on providers everywhere, and I do think that some of the people facing the biggest challenges will continue to be rural providers. So you're right, that's fairly intuitive. I don't have a bunch of data for that. Are there any other questions? I know Oliver reminded us that everybody who signed in will get these slides emailed to them. You will have our email addresses, so you'll know how to follow up with the individual analysts to get, to answer your questions. The slides have some source information on them. We'll make sure that you have that. The what to take away slide, which is maybe not in front of us, but I do want to remind you that if there's one thing that you remember, I hope it will be that graphic of the Block Grant showing the dramatic cuts, showing Medicaid funding dropping by 20% in the second year of the Block Grant. So if there's anything, any sort of misconception that we need to overcome here at the legislature, is that a Block Grant of Medicaid for Texas would mean a dramatic reduction in funding if it follows the pattern of the legislation that the top leaders in Congress have proposed in the last 2 years. So, you know, if we want to see a different and better outcome, it's going to require paying a lot of attention to it and changing the parameters of what they're talking about.